Welcome back. In 2003, when Kathleen Folbigg was given a 25-year sentence for smothering her four children to death, she was labelled Australia's worst female serial killer and Australia's most hated woman.
But she has always maintained her innocence, and legal experts say the Folbigg case will go down in history as one of Australia's biggest miscarriages of justice. The Sunday Telegraph senior reporter Jane Hansen is the host of a new podcast, Mother's Guilt, which delves into Kathleen's case, and we'll also follow a new inquiry starting on November 14. They join us live now, along with Kathleen's oldest friend, one of Kathleen's oldest friends, Tracy Chapman. Jane and Tracy, welcome to the show. Jane, I'll start with you. 151 world-renowned scientists are petitioning for Folbigg's release, claiming two of the children died of natural causes. Is this the mother of all injustices?
Well, if you follow the science, yes. The science is compelling. Here we have proof that two of the children, Laura and Sarah, carried a mutation on a gene that is now well documented to cause cardiac arrhythmias and sudden death in babies.
Just heartbreaking, particularly for Kathleen to lose her children this way. Tracy, you've been friends with Kathleen for many, many years. You've always maintained Kathleen's innocence. You've spoken to her last night. How is she feeling ahead of this new inquiry?
Of course, she's as nervous as we all are. And, I mean, she's the one going through all of this. She's the one that has all the accusations, fronted by the accusation. So I guess from our perspective, she's just hopeful and she's really just keen to that there's a transparent, fair, open inquiry, that the right experts are going to be used and the right questions are asked this time, because we were a little disappointed at 2019.
Yeah, and Jane, in the podcast you talk with Karen Hall, who babysat for Kathleen. Can you talk us through what she witnessed and why it is so important?
Okay, so about 8 months before Laura died, Karen Webb was looking after Laura, who was about 12 months of age at the time, and she stopped breathing while she was asleep, and Karen came in and saw her colour, saw that she was blue, grabbed her, started CPR, and then the child came through. Now, this has now been confirmed as possibly Laura's first cardiac arrhythmia event, and had Karen not roused her, she probably would have died in her sleep there and then. But it underpins the science that's now, evident 20 years later, that this was probably the child's first cardiac arrhythmia. And it's well documented that these things can cause sudden death in children now. There's a world expert called Professor Peter Schwartz who now has a register of these children and people that actually carry these genes or these mutations on the particular gene called the CALM2 gene. So the clue was always there, but the genetics hadn't caught up yet. I think 2003 was when the Human Genome Project first began, and it's taken all this time for the science to catch up. It's just devastating to think that, these children have died of natural causes and a woman that we possibly should have had compassion for has been burnt at the legal stake.
Yeah. Tracy, despite the science, Kathleen's ex-husband maintains that she's guilty. Were you close to him when they were married?
Yeah. I was in Sydney after Kathleen born and long after. So I was around for some of the time and then sort of lived vicariously through my parents and obviously other friends that maintained, regular contact with Kath in Sydney while I was in Sydney. Craig, I was surprised because Craig maintained Kath's innocence for a very long time, and for him to turn around at the trial in 2003 and change and say she was guilty, it was very shocking to all of us.
You've known Kathleen for a very long time. Can you describe what she was like as a mother?
Kath is a really doting mum. I mean, my mum spent a lot of time with her, especially with the boys, so she was always over at our house. So, yeah, she was a really doting mother. Mum always commented on how clean the children were and how well looked after they were, and everybody that, I didn't know any of the other children really, but Caleb, and he was very well dressed and well looked after and well loved. She was an affectionate mum, so it's very confronting to hear people say otherwise, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Jane, much has been made of Kathleen's diary entries as proof that she did smother the children. What do you make of those?
OK, so in 2003, it was a circumstantial case. So they had no forensic evidence that the children had been smothered. There was no evidence whatsoever. So what was relied upon was these diaries, which when you take some of the entries out, they're disturbing, and they certainly don't do Kathleen any favours. But if you understand how bereaved parents journal, and I'm one of, I've been there myself, and mine read, my read pretty similar. I blame myself if I didn't do this, if I didn't do that, if I didn't get stressed out, if I didn't let my boss upset me, maybe my child would still be alive. And the diaries are there for everyone to read on the website. And if you take them in context and you read them in context, they're actually devastating. But this is the problem that we have with circumstantial cases when there is a lack of evidence and a lack of science. Suspicion is inserted. And in this case, it's possibly going to go down as one of Australia's biggest injustices.
And it's certainly a podcast that you've been pushing for the past couple of years. It is out today. News Corp's latest true crime podcast is called Mother's Guilt. You can find it at mothersguilt.com.au. Jane and Tracy, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate your time, and we'll certainly be keeping across this story.
Thanks, ladies.
Thanks very much. Thank you.